So the 60s allowed for a revolution of the spirit. It wasn't a revolution, a 1776 revolution. We weren't trying to overthrow the government. We were trying to open the hearts of the people in charge and let the light shine in. Open the doors of perception, open the heart, let the love out of your heart. Make love, not war. That's what the 60s were all about. And it was a marvelous time. It was full of expectation. We thought we could perhaps change the destiny of America.
Musically, we were the revolution, you know. I think when kids saw us, they might have come away with a little different idea about what they might be doing the next day or the next year, I hope.
So, the Doors finally get to go to Europe. And they're going to play a couple of gigs with the Jefferson Airplane. Psychedelic West Coast, San Francisco and Los Angeles comes to London to play the Roundhouse. We had a couple of incredible gigs with the Jefferson Airplane. Absolutely magical, mystical, couldn't have been better. Now we move on to a couple of other gigs, and we're going to rejoin them in Copenhagen. So we went to Germany, we played in Germany, and it completely went over their heads. They had no idea what the Doors were doing or anything, and we said, well, God almighty, let's play at least play the Whiskey Bar. Maybe they'll like that. And that was the worst possible thing, because Brecht and Weill were communists, and we're playing in West Germany. We don't know. This is German. No, it's not German. It's a communist. Oh, my God. So it was a total disaster.
I would say the audiences in Europe, they primarily stared at us. They just were like we were in from Mars or something. And you could tell, you could feel pin drop time and knew they were with us. But it wasn't this, oh, Doors, Doors. It was just like, God, what is that, you know?
But in Europe, we just played our music. I think our music was such a political statement that the Doors could come out of a country like America. I think the Europeans innately understood that there was no reason for political discussion. The Doors, the music was the political discussion. The music was politics. The art the Doors created was of a political nature and a revolutionary nature.
So anyway, we were over in Europe, and we did a show in Denmark. And somebody asked us if we'd play a TV show the next day. So we said, okay, why not, you know? And then they told us the bad news, which was we'd have to get there at like 6 in the morning or 7 in the morning because they were shooting something else later. So we did, and it was kind of like waking up in a dream, you know? It's like, because you don't sleep too well over there anyway in Europe.
Denmark, they didn't speak English there, so they're definitely having to get the vibe, and they were more quiet.
So in a sense, the Danish show is a pretty good representation of a Doors set. It's a truncated Doors set, and I think you'll find that if you went to see a Doors concert, what the Danish show is a Doors concert on a sound stage with good sound and good camera work and good lighting.
That was a real, it was tough to pull a performance out in that conditions like that, I'll tell you. And I was pretty proud of how we did.
This was like the culmination. He had come to his home state, he's from Florida. The Lizard King had come to Florida. The Kings of Acid Rock had come to Florida, as we were called, the Kings of Acid Rock. And the people in Florida were strange and edgy. And it was one of those hot Southern Tennessee Williams nights. It was swampy and a strange place to be playing. Far too many people. Place held maybe 9,000-10,000 people. 14,000-15,000 were packed in. It was heat and hot. And it was a strange night. And Morrison was going to do his version of the living theater.
Well, you know, the Miami thing, which was really nothing. I mean, when you consider that Hair was playing at, Oh Calcutta was playing in the same city in Miami at the same time with total frontal nudity. And in reality, Jim never even did pull it out. He just said he was going to. But.
And he kind of fumbles around down there as if he's unzipping himself, and then he holds the shirt and says, "Watch this. Watch this. I'm going to show it to you. Psh, psh. Did you see it? Did you see it? Watch it again. Hey, here it comes. I'm going to show it to you." Psh, psh. And that's what he did. He kind of played matador with it. And I don't think he had done anything. You know, I mean, he might have unzipped his pants or something, but he was wearing big boxer shorts, and I don't see how he could have fumbled it through there, and just, he couldn't have extracted the weasel from those boxer shorts. And I don't think it ever happened, but by God, he convinced them, "I've done it, I've done it, I'm showing it to you, I'm showing it to you." He just, he and John and Robbie and I are going, chung, 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 hypnotic music, oh, gong, 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 keeping that whole thing going. And I think he just, you know, it was a modern day vision of Lourdes, except instead of seeing the Holy Mother or seeing Jesus on a tortilla or the Blessed Virgin on a hillside as we do today, I think the people saw snakes. I think they had come to see the Lizard King, the swampy Florida, and they saw snakes, and I don't think a snake ever appeared.
You know, people think, oh, rock and rollers are, you know, they're crazy and they're gonna go too far, you know, and that's, and really we didn't go too far that night, but because after the show, we were drinking beers with the cops upstairs in the dressing room, nobody got arrested or anything. And it wasn't until a week later when some politicians decided to make a big stink about the supposed riot that had happened that Jim got arrested.
Jim was feeling the pressures of Miami when we did the show, when we did the PBS show, because he hadn't even been on trial yet. So all of those charges were pending. He was going to trial. They didn't set a date yet. And Jim was scared. Jim was up on four charges that would have resulted, if he had been convicted of all of those charges, he would have done 3.5 years in something called Rayford Penitentiary down there in the county of Dade, Florida, or as we called it, the county of the dead.
He purposely gained a little weight, grew a beard. What was he trying to do? Hide? I don't know. Maybe a little, and also trying to etch out a new persona.
It was funny to hear these people, you know, critiquing the Doors. And this one guy especially who was so sure that we would be a passing fancy and never last more than to the next year. And, you know, he was saying how we definitely would not influence anybody, you know. And here, you know, 30 years later, you see the Doors' influence in so many groups.
When the critique show was on, we were in the trial at Miami, off and on, and the whole press was that, you know, Jim exposed himself. And so Al talks like he saw the ivory shaft, you know. He's sure of it. I was there, it didn't happen.
What I really laughed at was 10 years later when Prince came along and proved Jim's prophecy about a guy alone working in a basement with some machines and a computer making a record all by himself someday, and Jim turning out to be a visionary and Arnowitz turning out to be, you know, someone with you know, his eyes on backwards.
And here he is saying, well, I don't know if the Doors are gonna last. And you know, Morrison is so far ahead of the rest of the band, I don't even know why they're together. Well, obviously Al wasn't in the band because he bought the media thing that pushed Jim out front. And in fact, one concert when we were introduced as Jim Morrison and the Doors, Jim went, wait a minute, and said, no, ladies and gentlemen, the Doors, because we wrote everything together, we shared everything, and for a few years, there was a real democracy. It was a sweet thing for a little while. it's not a rock and roll beat. The end is, you know, on here be. That was on the cymbals. It's this slow, moody kind of thing. It's not, come on, baby, you know. And although I saw heads bobbing up and down out there, so I knew we were on to something.
Well, I guess we only had so much time, you know, 10 minutes or 15 minutes. And, you know, that was our most powerful piece. We figured, here we are in national Canadian television. Let's give it to them, you know.
I mean, they would stay on one guy for two verses, you know, and then there was four shots in the song, you know what I mean? Like, for half the song, they'd be on Ray's hands or something, you know, and so it was, I'd be back there working my ass off, and you'd see the pores in Jim's face.
And the guys are extremely young, handsome and good-looking, and Morrison was just in absolutely top form, and we did the end.
The song is based loosely on Indian raga tuning, Ravi Shankar stuff. And ragas are 20 minutes, you know. You wait a half hour to get to that climax in